You hear me? Yeah. So, thank you so much for being here. My name is Pablo Rodriguez Lozano. I'm a postdoc researcher at UC Berkeley in Stephanie Carson Lab. I did my PhD at Barcelona, and a fun fact is I met Stephanie in 2014 in a SFS conference in Portland, in a bar. So it's important to go to SFS conference and to bars also in the social meeting. The other two collaborators of this piece of work are Hannah Moidu, that is a PhD student in our lab, and Rob Lady, that is he works in the EPA. So most of you know that more than the half of the river network in California are intermittent rivers, and when we talk about these systems and fish, we used to talk about how important are permanent pools as a refuge for these fish. However, there are less papers, less people studying which are the consequences for fish when they survive in these isolated pools. So when we talk about non-lethal effects, we can talk about different things. We can talk about fish growth, parasites, lipid content, somatic conditions, also size structure, but here I'm going to talk about fish body condition as a proxy of the physical health of the fish populations. One of the first papers that talk about that, about which were the consequences of flow intermittency in the fish population, in the fish body condition, was one published in 2010, that they found that the fish body condition was lower in an intermittent tributary compared to the perennial main stream in a river. And they found that in the spring, so they suggest, with this found, that probably the intermittency impact was so high on the fish body condition of the fish that this prevailed during all the wet season. After that, there were a few papers about that topic. For instance, in 2012, they found in two waterholes, two fish species, how the body condition of these two fish species decreased in isolated waterholes. But however, just after a few rains, it seems like they recover. Also after that, in 2014, people start thinking about how to use this fish body condition also in assessing ecosystem health and incorporating this thing in bioindication. The objective of our study, that I'm going to show only the preliminary results, is to study how the hydrological variability of intermittent streams can affect the fish body condition of different fish species. But we are interested in different topics. First is the intra-annual variability, so what happened during the dry season, but also we are interested in what happened in different years when different climate conditions. We are also interested in the spatial variability because the pools can be really different and also the reaches are really different, but also we're interested in how different species respond to this flow intermittency, because maybe one species is really adapted and the flow intermittency didn't affect the fish body condition. So we studied Coyote Creek, the headwaters. The main stream of the Coyote Creek is perennial, but the headwaters are intermittent. And in the headwaters is really a big refuge for native fish species. We have Sacramento sucker, Sacramento pacmino, California roach, a brook lamprey, Rifle spooting, and also a lot of amphibians, mussels. What we did is a really non-lethal, non-invasive, really inexpensive methodology. We just electrofish the pools, measure the length and the weight, and calculate the fish body condition that is really easy to calculate. We sampled 10 different pools during the dry season in a monthly basis. So we did it in 2017, in August, September, and October. And now this year, in July, August, September, and October. I'm not going to show the October data because we went to the field this Monday, two days ago. And for each pool, we try to measure 40 individuals for each species. Only we measure individuals that are bigger than 30 millimeters in the fork length. This is the hydrograph of Coyote Creek from January 2014 till a week ago. So you can see this interannual variability, but also the interannual variability. So 2017 was a really wet year, and however, this year is a dry average year. When we go to the field, we also are working in do a wet-dry mapping. So here in this map, you can see in green the 10 pools. This is the 5 miles area that we are studying. And in blue, you can see the wet areas, and in red, the dry areas. So here I'm comparing the September 2017, when you can see there are a lot of wet areas because it was a wet year. And however, in September 2018, a month ago, most of the 5 miles were dry. And when we talk about interannual variability, I'm talking about this thing we are seeing here. This is one of the 10 pools. So this is July 2018, when the pool started to be isolated, then August 2018, and this was 2 days ago. So here are the first results. This is the body condition for the California roads in 2017 and 2018. And what we see here is that the fish body condition during the dry season of the wet year, 2017, was increasing during the wet during the dry season. However, during 2018, the fish body condition started decreasing. This is a little bit tricky because in 2018, this year, all the pools, the 10 pools, become isolated really early. However, in 2017, that was really wet, 5 of the 10 pools never become isolated. They were connected all the year. So here we can compare the data only of 2017, comparing the 5 pools above, where the 5 pools that were connected all the year, with the 5 pools that were isolated during the summer. So we can see how the fish body condition of California roads increased in those pools that were connected, but decreased in the pools that were isolated. And what happened is then in October, at the end of the dry season, because the first rains came in November 16, there is a significant difference in the fish body condition when we compare these two kind of pools. And this suggests that it's not just the wet year what is important, but also the pools that remain connected during these wet years. Here we have other two fish species, the Riffle sculpin and the Sacramento sucker, and both show the same tendency. So the fish body condition increased during 2017, the wet year, and decreased during 2018. And when we go again to the 2017 data for Riffle sculpin, what we see is the same tendency for the California roads, that in the isolated pools, the fish body condition decreased, but the pools that stay connected all the dry season in the wet year, the fish body condition increased. However, there is one fish species that we studied that have a different response. It was the Sacramento pike minnow. In this case, it seems that both dry seasons were really bad for the fish body condition of this fish species, so that the wet year is not having this role in this species. When we go to only the 2017 data for the Sacramento pike minnow, we see that there is not a real difference between the pools that were connected and were disconnected. It can be also because this fish species is bigger, it's a piscivorous fish species that have other physiological requirements. So it's important to know that not all fish species respond in the same way to the flow intermittencies in perennial rivers, in non-perennial rivers. So this was, they were like just preliminary data. The next step, we are going to calculate the fish body condition using other techniques. And also, we have a lot of variables that we are measuring in the fields, like the days, the number of days that the pool had been disconnected, the physical chemistry, like the dissolved oxygen, the water temperature, etc. Also, like the pool size, the max depth can be also a really important variable. And also the predation risk for other fish species, because the Sacramento pike minnow is a piscivorous species, so can be also affecting their presence to the fish body condition of other fish species. So just to finish, like the main message here is yes, the flow intermittency has non-lethal effects on the fish species, but however, in that pools that remain connected during the dry season in the wet year, the body condition of the California roads and the Riffle sculpin improve over time. So there is an important message here that not only perennial pools in intermittent rivers are important, but also these wet years, and especially those ridges that remain perennial during these wet years, can be really important to preserve the health of the fish population in those streams. And also the important thing is, like, our data suggests that Pike minnow is really vulnerable to these conditions, even in wet years. Thank you so much.
Are there differences in diets between the species, and are there differences in food availability between connected and disconnected pools?
Yes. So the pike minnow, the Sacramento pike minnow, is piscivorous. However, for example, the sucker is a bottom feeder, while the roach is more like invertebrates, omnivorous. The other question? The connected and disconnected, yeah. I think the food availability is really different because, for instance, when it's connected, the macroinvertebrates are available because of the drift, so the food is renewable. But I think the response of the fish body condition is not so related to the food availability, it's more related to the it's a physiological response. I think it's more related to when just the pool becomes disconnected, the DO really drops down, the water temperature here in Henry Cove can be like really, really high. So the water temperature becomes really high, and also other physical chemistry parameters, like probably the ammonium, the phosphates increase. I think it's more related to the physiological response to this.
Do you have an idea of how abundance is changing in those pools, and there's mortality?
Yeah, so a lot of times we
find... I don't think anyone heard him.
Sorry.
Do you have an idea about abundance in those pools and how if there's mortality among the species?
So we've several times we found a lot of like dead individuals in the pools, but I feel, I mean, it's not so important. I think when the pool is still there, I mean, the survival is really high because because we're focused in distant pools that are usually like big pools that we know are permanent pools, most of them. But when we do like the wetland mapping, we also see other tiny pools that just dry completely in July, and then it's when you see like the more deadly events. Do you have other questions?
Pablo.